Jeff Antoniuk. Welcome to the Guided Listening brought to you by jazzwire.net. So I have been kind of on a monk kick. Well, honestly, for about 35 years, I've been on a monk kick. But I'm thinking about Thelonious Monk inside Jazzwire. We have adult amateurs, semi-pros, working in three different communities. So working at three different levels. Two of the songs we're doing right now, we're doing Monk's Dream with some of the novices in the green community. And we're working on the song Aranel with the blue community, the more advanced players inside Jazzwire. And we're doing all this leading up to the winter summit that's coming up, looks a little like that, in January of 2023. And we've got some super special guests coming, including the George Coleman on saxophone, but who I've been thinking about a lot is Buster Williams on the bass. And Buster didn't play with Monk, but he played with a lot of folks that did. Buster Williams played in the band Sphere for a long time with Kenny Barron playing this music. So I have some questions for Buster Williams about playing bass on a Monk tune versus playing bass on a Charlie Parker tune or a Freddie Hubbard tune. How is that different? Is it different? How do you approach it differently? Monk approached his music differently. That's why I want to be doing some listening here, listening to he and his band. It's John Orr on bass, I believe. It's Frankie Dunlop. I've got a couple favorite Monk drummers, but Frankie Dunlop is definitely one of them. Charlie Rouse, definitely my favorite sax player with Monk, in that he had a lot of, you know, Monk's spirit, I think, in his playing. And I want to talk about what does that mean? He had Monk's spirit. Like, great, he had Monk's spirit. He was in the room with Monk. He caught the vibe. Whatever. I want to know what he's doing on the saxophone. And I want to be able to tell my students. I want to be able to tell you. Great that he had Monk's spirit. Like, that kind of stuff, it doesn't bother me exactly. But we can dig deeper. Right? I think we can be lazy and just kind of say it's the muse or it's the spirit or Monk rubbed off on him or he grew up, you know, in this kind of setting. That's all important. It's so, so important. But I didn't get any of that. You didn't get any of that. How are we going to get closer? This is how we're going to get closer. So anyway, if you're interested in finding out more about the Jazzwire Winter Summit, which is January 27th through 29, visit the website. We have, I think it's 8 spots left to work with Buster Williams, with Paul Bolenback on the guitar, with myself, with George Coleman, with Tia Fuller on the saxophone. And this is all done online, real time, playing together a ton, more playing together than you would do if we were in the same room. It really works. It's very powerful. I hope you join us. Okay, so Monk's Dream. Of course, a cool, quirky tune written by Thelonious Monk. And so I want to jump into it. I want to listen to it. I'm going to point out a couple things in advance. As we listen, if you've listened to any Thelonious Monk, you are aware of some Monk-isms, perhaps. Things that he, like we know that, I've used the word quirky probably 10 times already, the quirkiness of his playing. But there are extremely predictable things that he does. He was an unpredictable guy by all accounts, but there are things in his playing that are predictable in an interesting, unpredictable way. But there are things he does almost every time. Ethan Iverson, a great piano player, contemporary piano player, did a really cool blog recently where he was saying, I'm going to paraphrase, I hope I didn't get it wrong, but the spirit of what he said is, of all the jazz musicians, Monk probably improvised the least. He had things a little more worked out, more than most. How does Ethan Iverson know this? He listened. He listened to a bunch of versions of Monk playing the same tune, and we hear Monk doing the same dang thing on 10 different recordings in the same place. So yes, that's not his thought. It's not that he's angry at Monk for not improvising more. That's the reality. It's interesting. Okay. So we're going to hear, you know, Monk and some of his Monkisms. One of the things he does is use a ton of the melodies inside his solo. So as improvisers, you know, all of us have been coached, man, use the melody. It's there. It's so great. Why not use the melody? And of course, almost none of us do most of the time, right? Monk is, there's no greater example of that. Okay. So we hear that in his playing. With Charlie Rouse, there's, to get that sort of bouncy, quirky sound, there I've said it for the 15th time, quirky. Rouse does this consciously unswinging thing, or sort of a ricky ticky thing, but da-da-da-da-da-da-da, you know, kind of a cute, you know, tiptoe through the tulips kind of phrasing. And he does it, it's part of how he plays. And when he's not playing with Monk, he will do this kind of thing. And what it is, da-da-da-da-da, on the beat, he'll play a short note. Instead of ba-ba-da-ba-da, he'll play ba-ba-da-ba-da. It's really, really cool. And it has a bounce to it and has a lilt. It's not jazz, it's not swinging, but he does it a lot. And as we listen through the recording, we'll often hear when he takes a breath full of air and plays a phrase, 2, 3, 4, 5 measures long, he'll do that little thing in almost every phrase. It's just sort of a part of him. That's why I think his musical personality fit with Monk so well, that there was sort of a fun, I'm not going to say the Q word for the 16th time. I probably will. I apologize in advance. Let's listen to this tune and kind of dig what's going on. It's an interesting song because the band doesn't start swinging and walking right out of the gate. So see if you can hear what the bass and drums are doing behind the melody. Here we go. Okay, those rhythmic hits in the bass and drums. And little drum fills. Here it is again. Drum fill. Drum fill. So there's a lot of cool space for a drummer to be playing the melody more than a drummer usually does, and then to fill around that. By the way, where's Charlie Rouse? No saxophone yet. Very interesting for a drummer and a bass player to play a Monk tune. Very cool. Okay, here should be the first solo. Okay, so no saxophone on the melody, but he comes in with the first solo. So let's listen to Charlie Rouse and his articulation. Da 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 da, right there. We're gonna hear that a ton. Very swinging. Man. Da 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 da. That's a Charlie Rouse-ism right there. We're gonna hear that a bunch. There it is again. Now that you're used to it, you're gonna hear it da 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 all over the place. And where's Monk gone? So now we're left with a trio, bass, drum, saxophone. Monk comp for the first chorus, but now he's out. So those repeated notes are cool. Bum, 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 bum. Monk used a lot of repeated notes, and we hear that in Charlie Rouse's playing too. That articulation. Da, 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 da. So another chorus. Monk is still out. So Frankie Dunlop on the drums. He does this cool thing where he'll accent on the beat. It's kind of like what Charlie Rouse is doing on the beat with articulations. We're going to hear a lot of drum hits on beat 2 or 4, not the and of 2 and the and of 4, like a lot of drummers would do. 1, 2, 4. So that is the backbeat, but it's different than that. He's landing on those spots. He just did a number of them there. He's landing in weird places, in quirky places. He's a quirky drummer. Okay, Monk solo. Repetition. Plays the same thing 3 times, 4 times in a row, right out of the gate. Repetition, that's Monk. Listen to the comping, what he's doing with his left hand, melody in the right hand. Sometimes it's one note comes back. So Monk would toy with texture a ton. A lot of piano players would, you know, comp with 2-3-4-note voicings in the left hand, you know, as a matter of course. Monk would mix it up a ton. And we hear lots of these half steps and whole steps, these clusters, these clanky kind of sounds, which are great. That's Monk again. Those descending lines from up high. Monk does that all the time. So that's one of those things that Ethan Iverson was talking about. And the bass and drums just cranking away. But it's fun to listen to Frankie Dunlop and hear how he's talking to Monk, especially with the snare drum and the bass drum. Those are two of the biggest places that a drummer improvises with. So there's the melody, right? So he's been hinting at the melody in various places. So is he playing the melody? Almost sounds like he's playing the melody now. Improvising with it a bit, changing it, but it sounds like he's playing the melody on the way out. Here's the bridge. Great drum fills around the melody. So I guess this is the head out, right? This is the last A section, and he really morphed from his solo into the melody out. It's hard to tell where one began and where the other ended. Oh, melody again. Okay, so he's doing the melody a whole other time with Charlie Rouse. Do you hear that? It's like a drum fill that Monk did on the piano. Monk is playing the piano like a drum. Comping, we comp on the drums, we comp on the piano. They're both rhythmic, right? Monk plays the piano like a drum. He absolutely does. How he's harmonizing these weird ways, it's fantastic. And now, Frankie Dunlop had those fills that Monk kind of took earlier. All right. Wow. I love that Charlie Rouse solo, and for, you know, decades I've been meaning to learn that opening line. But it's such a great, wild, angular thing that he plays, and I've definitely transcribed bits and pieces of Charlie Rouse over the years, and it's always so inside the changes and really correct. Not that he doesn't, you know, do interesting things, he certainly does, but he's able to be so interesting, you know, diatonically, or, you know, using the language of the day, lots of sharp 11s and things like that. His playing just brings a smile to my face, and that shape and that articulation that he had to have used 20, 30 times in that solo. And that would be something I might do as an effect once in the evening. Not once in a song, not 20 or 30 times in a song, but that was part of his personality, right? Some of those clusters and that sort of, you know, Monk comping, that was Monk's personality. That was in everything he did. So, you know, a contemporary great piano player of the day, you know, in this year would certainly know Monk's language and they would pick some of those things out. But most people aren't trying to just do a thorough copy of Thelonious Monk all the time, right? We're all trying to develop our own personality. So I take a bit from Monk, I take some Oscar Peterson, I take some Bill Evans, I take some Richie Bayrak, whoever it is, right? And then that becomes who I am. So fascinating. And that's the way to listen into this stuff is, you know, to listen to our instruments and find out what people are doing on our instruments. Then listen to the great players on other instruments. Is there something that Monk is doing that I could do on the saxophone? I would love to know if Charlie Rouse sounded like Charlie Rouse before Monk, or did Charlie Rouse become the Charlie Rouse I know because of his time with Monk? I'd love, you know, the environment, right? I'd love to know that. Or were these two guys that just when they met, it was magic? Not sure. That would be very interesting. So knowing our instrument, knowing other folks' instrument, and how can I translate Bill Evans to the saxophone? How can I translate John Patitucci to the saxophone, from the bass to the saxophone? Interesting questions. And then always, if we're not a bass player and a drummer, knowing the role of the bass and the drums. The more we know about what those folks are doing behind us, first of all, the happier they are. We want happy bass players and drummers. We honestly do. Because when they're crabby, they'll make you sound bad. So stay friends with the bass player and the drummer, kind of learn more about what they do and have musical conversations with them. And Frankie Dunlop is one of the great conversationalists, I would say. And again, he fit into Monk's music so well by sort of turning some of the conventions of jazz drumming a little bit on their head. So I hope you enjoyed that. And I hope you're going to be joining us at the Jazz Wire Winter Summit in January. And I would love to see you inside Jazz Wire, working 7 days a week with myself, with the rest of the faculty. We have people from 25 different countries around the world. You can take a free trial, so don't take my word for it. Come in, do a 30-day free trial. You can sign up right here. It'll take you, honestly, about 10 seconds. You will be inside. You can look at the lessons that we've been doing on these songs and go from there. So I'll look forward to seeing you inside Jazz Wire, and I'll see you next week. Enjoy hanging out with Monk.